Poza rządem. Program o organizacjach pozarządowych.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Martina, and you're listening to Radio Prismat. Today we are continuing with the topic of volunteering. For the ones who were not with us the last time, I'm a volunteer here in Krakow, together with 28 other volunteers from 14 different countries. We are spending 9 months here volunteering in different hosting organizations like schools, kindergartens, and in the library, while our coordinating organization, our mother hen, so to say, it's TRIM, Youth Development and Integration Association. Last time, we talked about the concept of volunteering, about the process of applying and going abroad. And we had Sam as a guest here in the studio. And this was Fire by Seth Powers, and you're listening to Prismat Radio. We are back in the studio now, ready to introduce our special guest. Hello, Anna, and welcome.
Hello, thank you very much for letting me be here.
So, Anna, like I said, you are also a volunteer here.
Yes, I am.
Can you tell us a little bit about yourself?
My name is Anna. And I'm from Spain, from the south of Spain, Córdoba. It's a city. It's a really hot city, so I have trouble being here, but I'm happy. I'm 22 years old, and I just graduated from my university, translation and interpreting. I can speak, obviously, Spanish and also English and French, a little bit of German, and I'm trying to learn Polish a little bit.
So, how did you decide to apply for volunteering abroad? Was it a hard decision for you?
It was hard because I was so confused. I wasn't sure if I wanted to do a master's degree in the moment that I finished university. I wasn't sure if it was the right decision for me, if I was going to take like a gap year, if I wasn't going to get anything about this. Mm-hmm. But then I was calm. It was just me and myself. And being a little selfish, let's say, and only thinking about me. And I did it, and right now I'm really happy.
Yeah, you're satisfied with your decision.
I'm super satisfied, yeah. I think it was the right one.
Me too. So, okay, you decided to go, and you were satisfied with your decision, but how did your family react, or your friends?
My friends didn't really understand what was European Voluntary Service, because it's not something that Spanish people do. In Spain, when you finish university, you have a master's degree, and you don't get, apart from Erasmus, you don't get another scholarships. So when I told them, I'm going to do an EVS. What is an EVS? And they were like, oh, but that's volunteering. You won't get paid. You won't get nothing, you know, as a profit after your university. You will just waste a year. My mom was really proud of me because we will talk about it later, but my job here is related to my degree, so I'm happy for that. But my friends, after I explained that a little bit, they were more, let's say, okay, she won't waste a year, she will improve herself and she will learn another language, which is also really important in my degree. But it was good. Like at the end of the day, when I was on my plane, everyone was happy, so that was good.
But it took a lot of
explaining. Yeah, it took a lot of explaining, and it's not something, sadly, EVS is not something that is spread all over the world, and neither in Spain. So I wish we could translate this radio show in Spanish so we can just put it in Spain. But at the end, it was hard a little bit.
Yes, I think what you said, it's something that many young people who want to do EVS or who already decided to do an EVS see, and they have to confront those things, because some people say, just like they told you, but you will get nothing out of it.
Yeah.
Or some people ask, okay, so it's like an internship.
Yeah.
And then you say, no, it's not like an internship.
Yeah, but it's neither only just a volunteering.
Yeah.
It's more than that.
It's definitely a huge experience. But
yeah.
I'm glad that after you explained everything, they were supportive.
Me too.
Because it's easier for them and for you that way. Okay, so we are staying here all together for 9 months. Now we've been here for 3. And do you think it's hard to be so far away from home?
I get homesick. I get homesick a little bit, mostly because now we have a lot of social media and you see your friends off together going out and you are not there. You hear gossips that you are not there. When you have, for example, I have little cousins, and for example, when I went home for Christmas and I saw my goddaughter that grown up, you think, oh, I'm missing things.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, I think I'm young still, and I deserve new experience, not only being at home with my mom, just watching movies. I need to grow up also as a person, and I won't grow up alone if I'm always with her. So it gets hard, but I have really good flatmates, that's true. I have really good work environment, have really good people here in Poland helping me. So day by day, after these 3 months, I can seriously call Krakow my home.
I agree, me too. Because when I'm going home from work or from somewhere else, I always say, I'm going home. Hmm. And it's not my country, it's our flat here.
Yeah, you see the difference. At the beginning of the month, you were like, yeah, I'm going to the flat.
Yeah.
And now when we text, it's, I'm going home.
So I'm going home. Where are you? Are you home?
Yeah, are you home? Yeah.
Yeah, we are home. Okay, so we are here. We are working in our hosting organizations. But also an important part of being a volunteer in a foreign country especially is to explore the country and its culture. So before we get to some more serious questions, tell me, how do you like Krakow so far?
I love Krakow. I have been in a few Polish cities already, and Krakow has everything. Has modern parts, has old town parts, has the Jewish neighborhood, which is amazing. Right now the weather is treating us so good, so we cannot complain about that, because winter is not here yet.
Not yet.
Not yet. And I love it's a city that you can do a lot of things. Like, you feel like going to a museum on a Monday, or you have for free the Oscar Sidlec fabric, or even on Sunday you can go to a museum and it's open. You need milk. For example, the difference is in Spain, on Sundays there is no shops open, and in Poland there are. So it's you can do a lot of things, like some culturals, even just to go out, have a hot chocolate. It's a really city where you receive a lot of opportunities to do.
I agree. Whatever you want to do, whenever,
yeah, you can do
if
it.
It's a party, if it's just coffee, if it's going to the movies, whatever, you can do it anytime.
Yeah.
And yes, the stores are opened all the time.
Yeah,
that makes us very, very happy.
Yeah.
So far, do you have any favorite place or a part of the city that you really, really like?
Talking about museums, I have visited a few, but Oscar Sille Museum, if you want to visit an interactive museum where you learn the culture, what Poland surfer, it's such an interesting museum. It's so interactive, so explaining things. It's translated in English, so it's really, really, really nice. For places, I really, really like Coco. I mean, the beer is good, the food is really nice, and to have a hot chocolate, Café Magia, which, you know, it is really, really nice, even just you want to work. And also, I don't remember right now the name, but it's a little cafeteria where it's in the Jewish neighborhood.
Mm-hmm.
And it's also really, really, really nice.
Yes, there are definitely some wonderful,
yeah,
places. And I think we have a lot more to discover in the next 6 months.
I hope so.
Me too. So what about the culture? Have you tried some Polish food?
I have tried a lot. Probably way too many Polish food. And I really like it. I'm still trying to discover my favorite flavor of pierogi. Right now, it's, you know, meat is winning, but we will see who really wins. Sapiekanka, in Placnove, they are really good. Every single goulash, for example, also. But I haven't discovered the dish that I really, really, really fancy. I think I haven't yet. Maybe, you know, during these 6 months, I will tell you yes. At the end of June, I will tell you this is my dish. Because, yeah, pierogi is a really typical answer. And I'm tired of saying, yeah, my favorite
food
is pierogi. No, I need one.
But what I really love about pierogi, it's not just a touristic thing that only tourists like in Poland, in Krakow, but really Polish people that we've met, that we talk to, also really love pierogi, and that makes me really happy because we can share something with
them. Yeah, for me, the hard thing is, like, Polish people eat like 10 pierogi for lunch, and for me, eating 10 pierogis for lunch is, you know, die in bed with your stomach full. So I cannot do that. And when I hang out with Polish people, you know, they are like, oh, you're only eating 5 pierogis. Yes, I cannot eat more.
Yeah, we're just not used to it, but it's so delicious that it's really tempting to eat
it's
even
so
more
good
than 10.
Yeah.
And what about some traditions and celebrations? Did you participate in any here?
Yeah, I have been on the Mikowa, which we don't have that in Spain, for example. And my students, we will talk about that later, but my students gave me some chocolate, some presents, and I got really confused because I didn't know what we were celebrating until they told me, no, it's Mikowa. It's some kind of Santa Claus that they did it. And I got really confused. I got really shy because I didn't give them anything. So I was really embarrassed, not shy, like embarrassed because I didn't give them anything. But at the end, they explained me it, and you know, I'm from Spain, so we don't really do that, but that was good. And I'm probably still looking forward for more traditions that we will, you know, discover during these 6 months.
Yes, and I think we both participated in Andrzejki in St. Andrew's Day, which was very, very interesting.
That was
for
really,
me,
really interesting too.
Seeing all the different ways to predict your future and to see who you're gonna marry.
Yeah, that was crazy. And also on Christmas, sharing this, I don't know how can we call it,
Opłatek.
Yeah. That was really interesting, and I think it's really like a nice and sharing tradition. You know, like you share the bread. We don't do that. In Spain, so for me that was so touching also.
Yeah, we don't do it either in Croatia, so it was very nice, very nice. And maybe I will take that tradition and maybe take it with me to share with some of my friends and family. I was really lucky I stayed here for holidays.
This
was my first holidays without my family, but I did find a family here, really in Krakow, and I spent it with some of my friends who are Polish, so we had a very traditional Christmas Eve dinner, which was amazing, and the food was so yummy, and all the traditions, you know, were there, and it was really, really wonderful, and I'm so, so, so grateful. So, Hubert, Ola, if you're listening, thank you. It was amazing. It was maybe the best one I had so far.
Which was your favorite part of that dinner?
Oh, everything. Everything, really, because it was really good atmosphere. With great people, with these delicious foods, some of them I never tried before, and just staying with another family and in another family's home, because I kind of missed my home a little bit, especially for the holidays.
Yeah.
It was very, very nice. Huh. And of course, all the animals. They have 2 dogs and 2 cats and a bunny, and I miss
We do miss
pets.
Our animals a lot. We do miss our pets.
I think every volunteer just misses...
Yeah.
Their pets.
Sorry, Mom, but we miss our dogs more.
It's true.
Yeah,
it's true.
Not gonna lie.
So, like I said, we've been here in Krakow for 3 months now.
Yep.
Did you notice that something changed in these 3 months? Like from the beginning when we came here until now? Because I remember our first day. We are flatmates, so we really spent...
Time together
and we explored our life together here. And I remember the first day we were just trying to find a shop to buy some bread, to buy some milk, to find Biedronka somewhere.
Yeah.
And I remember it was sunny. It wasn't so cold. It was very
really
nice. And we were all so confused with the tram lines, with everything. And now I think we feel a little bit more like home.
Yeah, for me I was, you know, when you are going abroad, you have... Or you have like high expectations, low expectations. And I was really trying myself not to make expectations because I was thinking, oh, maybe they go too high and then they are, you know, less. And I remember our first day that we met, that I was the first one of the 4 of us that we lived together. And I met Martina. And she just, instead of shaking my hand, she was like, come on, you're Spanish. Give me a hug. And for me, that was when I said, oof, this is getting good. And then the 4 of us, we went, as you said, to Biedronka to search for it. We just needed milk. And that was, I knew that since that moment it would be good. Like at the beginning, you were like, oh, I'm not sure. You know, imagine we leave a German woman, a French woman, a Croatian woman, Spanish woman. It's like a bad joke.
Yeah.
Like we have. And they... You don't really know the cultures, their habits, how are they going to be with the house, with everything. But I'm really lucky. As I said, I have the amazing roommates, so I made everything easier. And obviously our relationship changed. Like at the beginning, we were just roommates. Now we are also friends. I feel more comfortable here. I know what Biedronka is. Yeah. That's really important.
That's really important.
Yeah, even Jabka. But I'm feeling really comfortable. I know where to go when I need something. I know who to ask. And I know if I have a problem, I have four amazing friends. Not only four, 20 friends. But talking about my roommates mostly, I can count on them every time.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. Yeah. I think it's always important to have even just a few people that you can count on, that you can ask for something. And I mean, if you imagine, we are all from different countries, we all speak different languages.
Yeah.
But it makes me really, really happy that in our flat, we don't speak just English.
Yeah.
That you can hear some German, you can hear some French, you can hear some Spanish, even you can hear some Croatian, even though no one can understand me.
No one.
we still do it, and I really have a nice feeling of togetherness with us.
My too.
And with some other volunteers, of course.
Yeah.
And it's just the sense of a city that you know where and how to go.
Yeah.
That you don't feel afraid to take the bus or the tram because you don't know where you will end up. So that's, I think it's really important for all of us.
Yeah, I think getting lost the very first days, that helped us a lot.
Yes.
Google Maps also, but now I hardly ever use Google Maps, but that's the good thing about it, that you get lost, and then I know the way.
And then you find your way back.
Exactly, as always, you always find your way back home.
Yeah, and then if you don't have internet, you can just find someone to ask them, even in really bad Polish.
Yeah, because we haven't talked about that. Everyone is here in Krakow speak English.
Yes.
Everyone, even old people or young, really young people, kids. And that's super amazing for me, because if you need help, even if it's not fluent English, they will try to help you. The best thing is they always
just
try
in Polish,
it.
No, to speak slower, just to explain whatever you need. And when in doubt, you know, if I really can't speak Polish, just a few words. And if they don't speak English or Spanish or whatever, I just use Croatian. And then we try to find...
Or Google Translate.
Or Google Translate.
Yeah.
Exactly. I think we'll be just fine.
We will.
And that was Two Kids by the DLX. And we are back in the studio of Radio Prizmat and talking about volunteering. Tonight, our special guest is Anna from Spain, who is a teacher here in Krakow, and she teaches English and Spanish. So, Anna, let's focus on your job now. Can you tell us what is your day like? What do you usually do?
I wake up really early. That's the first thing that you need to know. Then I mostly go I work from 9 until 3. And normally from Tuesday until Saturday. Because on Saturdays I teach English and Spanish for teenagers, so during the week they have classes, so they cannot come. And I teach Spanish for different groups, and English also for different groups. And then mostly we have at the library, because I work at the public library here in Krakow. And we prepare some different activities. For example, before Christmas we read poetry in our own languages. Because I work with four other volunteers, Sofia, which is German, Francesco, which is Italian, and Florian, which is French. And every single one of us, we teach English and our own mother tongue. And we prepare some kind of different events. This January, we will sing Christmas carols with seniors, and everyone is invited, obviously. And mostly that's what I do. And the second semester I will work in Arteteca as a librarian. I will also teach Spanish, but only one day during the week. Most of the days I will work just as a librarian and preparing different events. They always improve my creativity, and they let me do whatever I want in the way that I can propose my ideas. And if they can make them come true, they will do it.
So
I work with work people.
I think that you're really feeling comfortable in your work environment.
Yeah.
If I'm right.
Yeah.
Okay, and what about being a teacher? What is that like for you? Do you like it? Did you find yourself in it?
Yeah. 2 years ago, I worked as a teacher, Spanish teacher in Spain, which I was teaching Spanish to teenagers, which I really like it, because mostly I was teaching Spanish for Polish people, and I discovered that Polish people were really interested in Spanish, which for me, I thought no one wanted to speak Spanish.
Oh, like, come on, everybody wants to speak Spanish.
Yeah, that's what foreigners do. It's true. But in Spain, we have the, let's say, common sense set of no one wants to speak Spanish. Spanish is not like a really amazing language. Everyone wants to speak English, now Chinese, because it's a new language. But for me, they were really into my culture. They were really into my language. They were, because it's not the same when you're an adult, when you are, you know, learning a language, that when you're a teenager. That's a really different level. So for me, when someone is interested in my culture, it's so good. And here in Krakow, I work with different groups, seniors, adults, and teenagers. And the three groups, they are really interested, not only in the language, but in the culture. They ask me things that are happening in Spain. We talk about the news. We talk about traditions. And I don't really feel like I'm teaching. I feel like I'm spending an hour with friends. And I'm just explaining them my culture. That I'm just explaining them my language. I don't really take it as a job that I have to wake up every single morning and go to teach someone that doesn't is not interested in that. As you can imagine, in the library, the classes are free. So people, you can think, oh, just people just go because they are free. Not only because of that, it's because they're interested. And that's what makes me feel happy because, you know, when everything is free, you just take it. But it's good. I really like it.
Yeah, and they still take the time and they feel really motivated.
Yeah, to go. That's the word.
If
exactly.
You know, they didn't pay for it, they don't have to go, but they really want to, and they keep coming back to your classes.
Yeah, exactly.
So it means they like it.
Yeah.
It means they like it.
Yeah.
And, you know, I love Spanish, so I'm not surprised that other people want to learn and speak Spanish. But like you said, you're teaching Spanish and English,
mm-hmm.
and Spanish is your mother tongue. So I don't think it's the same to teach a foreign language to foreigners and your language to foreigners.
No. I studied English since I was a kid. So I know how I received the English classes. Mm-hmm. I know how I learned the grammar. I know how I learned the verbs. But with Spanish, I had to study Spanish to teach Spanish. Why? Because as every single person, everyone learns their own mother tongue by themselves.
Yes.
Not by themselves, like their mom talks to them. And for me, sometimes it's really difficult because mostly the advanced students, they ask me, okay, why is this like this? And sometimes I'm like, oh, I don't know. We say it like this.
Because we say it like this.
And sometimes I get really confused. And the only thing that I know is like, I don't know that yet, but I will tell you next week. And I have to go to the book of the Real Academia Española, which is the saint of books, and read that there. So it's hard because I don't really have to prepare. It's funny because the class that I prepare the most are the Spanish ones, not the English ones. The English ones, I know how I received the class. I know what was clear for me. I know why the things are like this. So they're easy. But the Spanish ones, mostly with intermediate level, they are really hard. I have to prepare them. It's not an easy job.
Yeah, I can imagine because I think at some point I also tried to teach some of my cousins who are living in Argentina. I tried to teach them some Croatian and they could already speak some, so it was great. But still, they ask me sometimes, why do you say this like this and not like that? It should be different, like according to the rules.
Yeah.
But you always have some exceptions. And I was much younger then, and all I could say, but it's how we say it, because it's just how we say it.
Exactly. Like sometimes, for example, even with Polish, when they ask you, when they tell me about, no, it's, I don't know, proszę bodę, it's the boda. Why? Okay, it's declination, but explain me why.
Yeah, and, why is it like that?
And some people are like, we just say it like that. So I just gave up. I was just, okay, this is like this. I'm not going to ask more questions.
Yeah. It's just kind of a spirit of the language.
Yeah.
Even if you speak a foreign language and you know a lot of different synonyms for the same thing, you know that it's not, you cannot always use the same words. Sometimes you need a synonym that is completely the same in the meaning, but just it doesn't fit.
That's that's why teaching is hard. Teaching your own language, you have to study your own language.
You have to learn how to teach your language.
Exactly.
I get it. I get it. You said that your students are really interested about your culture, about your traditions, about the news, what's happening. I think that is a great way for them to learn because it's when you're getting some information that are happening right now, it could be more interesting than if you just teach them grammar.
I think for learning a culture, a language, you need to learn the culture. You need to know how people think, how people, because sometimes you don't understand their behavior and you need to know why they do that. For example, all the traditions, all the little things that made their daily life in this case Spain, and they really like it. Sometimes they get like a cultural shock because we don't do the same.
Yes.
Obviously, you know that Poland and Spain is really different. And but as you said, they are so motivated. They are really motivated, and they understand, and that's the good thing, because they don't try to think as a Polish person that is learning Spanish. They really try to put themselves into a Spanish person, and that's what makes that special.
That is wonderful.
Yeah.
But how would you describe your teaching style? Like, do you use just things that other teachers taught you in school, or do you also make up some of your stuff, some games, some quizzes maybe?
It depends on the level. If we are talking about Spanish lessons, I have beginning of seniors and beginning of teenagers. With seniors, it's more less grammar.
Mm-hmm.
I don't explain them why. We learn vocabulary. For example, we learn how to survive at the airport. We learn how to survive at the restaurant, how to go to the doctor, because that's really important.
Yes.
Those three things, for example, I have a few seniors that all of them, they will travel to Spain in May, and they wanted to know, you know, if they get lost, how do they say that?
Yeah.
And it's not more like grammar. We see a few verbs, we see a few of conjugations, but not really grammar. With beginners of teenagers, we do see grammar. We do see, because they can have similarities with English. They can have more, let's say they have the base. So mm-hmm. we can teach also grammar, but I love a lot of songs, a lot of talking. I really like to make them talk. And with the intermediate, they know all the conjugations, all the tense, they know everything. So what I do mostly is talking. We talk about everything. We talk about colloquial expressions, and I don't follow any book. Sometimes when they ask me, for example, can we do this? I'm like, yeah, we can do that. They can. They ask me things, and I adapt my classes to them.
That's great. So you really try to help them in a way that they want to, not just what you think it's the best for them, but also listen to them.
Yeah, and obviously, cultural thing is the best thing for me when they... Because we have a good culture in Spain, I'm not going to lie.
Yeah.
And we have some kind of like interesting things, so they really like it. So I'm not only focusing on the grammar, because they say that, I have read that this, if you have teaching an hour, the 40 minutes, they are good, but the last 20 minutes, people disconnect. So
yeah.
I always use 40 minutes of grammar and then 20 minutes of cultural activities, games, songs, whatever. But... to make them still in the class and
not
go to bed.
So they don't drift away.
Exactly.
So just to close this chapter of our interview, can you try to think about and tell me what are the benefits of speaking a foreign language? Like just any foreign language, why is it good to learn? Why?
To let you know two things. Mostly two things that I'm more grateful that my mom did for me. The first one was teach me how to travel. And the second one was, since I was 3 years old, putting me into English class, into an academy. Why? Because you discover a new world. When you are traveling, for example, English is the international language, for example, in this case, and you can communicate with everyone. You met really cool people, and sometimes they don't speak, in this case, Spanish, they don't speak Croatian, they don't speak French, but everyone knows a little bit of English.
Yeah.
So some people say, no, I don't want to speak English because I'm not living in Spain. Oh, I don't want to speak English because I'm not living in Poland. Learning a new language is not only learning grammar, it's learning a new word, it's learning new adventures, it's learning to be open-minded. And I think that's the good thing that our generation has, that we are not close-minded. Like, sadly, there are still some people, but with learning languages, with the TV shows that are only in English, TV shows that, this really cool TV show that is only in Croatian. So yeah, they will put the English subtitles always. I think learning, as I said, learning a new language is a new adventure, new opportunity to just open your world, open your mind, and not only think about your own country, your own language, your own, but to the rest of the world. And I think that's why it's important to learn another one.
Yeah, somebody else too.
Yeah.
And this EVS so far for me, like, really opened up my eyes for some reason, because, okay, I speak English, obviously, and I can speak a little bit of Spanish, and I speak a little bit of German, and I understand maybe a little bit of Italian, but now we have also a roommate who is from France, and I would love just to speak a little bit of French, yeah. You know, just to speak, I don't know, a little bit of
Greek.
That's
the problem, that when you speak, when you start learning a language, you're like, oh, what if I try this language? What if I try this one? And then you end up, you know, getting really obsessed with languages, and that's what happens.
Yeah.
And it's good because, as I say, it's not only the language, it's the culture.
It's the culture and it's the sense of another person in another language, because we know each other mostly in English.
Yeah.
But just like I talk to some people and they say, yes, I know in English, but it's so weird. We are so close and we don't even communicate in my language or in your language. Yeah. We just communicate in English.
In English, yeah.
So, yes, English is wonderful and it's very handy.
It is.
It can just help you wherever you go,
and
whenever.
And even if you're applying for a job.
Also,
nowadays they see if you have English.
You need it.
It's
you
not anything. Okay, because another language, not yet. We will see about Chinese, because I'm worried about Chinese. But English now, they need it. You need it for a job nowadays. They look really at that. So.
Yeah, you cannot get any job without English. And I mean, Spanish is so beautiful.
Yeah.
So beautiful. And so many beautiful movies and so many beautiful songs. And I cannot imagine my life now without speaking Spanish, without understanding Spanish. And now I want to learn more German. And I hated German when I was a kid. And now I want to learn more so I can talk to people, so I can, you know, just travel more to just be with people another way.
And sometimes when people are really nice, because, for example, the woman that we have in the shop downstairs, she always speaks to me in English. She knows who I am. And sometimes I surprise her for little Polish words, and she gets so happy when she, you know, hears me speaking Polish. And now it's like, yeah, I want to speak Polish because, you know, this woman, she will, even the other person, motivates you to learn the other language.
Yeah, so they really appreciate. Even when people, like, who are volunteers, they just say one or two words in Croatian to me.
Yeah.
And I get happy because it's so nice of them, you know, just to... And it's funny. It's always funny, if nothing else.
Yeah, exactly. Because pronunciation is funny.
It's funny. Yeah. Always. okay, thank you. Thank you for this answer.